Thanks for tuning in. Welcome to the first video in my Constellation series, a science, lore, and history grand tour using backyard astrophotography. So let's start things off with Orion. Orion is quite possibly the most easily recognized constellation in the entire night sky. Pareidolia is a trick of the mind in which humans recognize patterns in an image that seems familiar to something else, like seeing clouds that look like animals or faces in various objects. Constellations and their names exist due to that very same phenomena. Perhaps seeing something that looks like a human figure in the night sky is why Orion is so recognizable to us. In mythology, in the most common examples, Orion is depicted as a hunter or a warrior, sometimes shown holding a sword, a club, or a bow, a shield, or even dispatching an animal, a belt at his waist, and a sheath, dagger, scabbard, or sword at his side. Almost every ancient culture depicts Orion as a deity, ruler, hero, or legend. But I think the visually stunning sight that is Orion is more amazing and inspiring than the myth. So let's peel back the layers, remove the clouds, the city lights, the sky glow. Let's collect the photons that have traveled thousands of light years and reveal Orion, the cradle and grave of star systems and planets, a beacon for ancient navigators, and today's pop culture icons. But first, let's get acquainted for where we are in relation to Orion. Like all constellations, its shape is a function of our perspective. Orion is along the equatorial plane of the Earth. That means a couple of interesting things. For one, this is where our geostationary satellites are located. So oftentimes, when photographing Orion, these satellites and their solar panels sometimes show up in these images. It also means that Orion is visible from just about anywhere on Earth where most people live, but difficult to see from Earth's poles. Orion is opposite from the galactic center. That means it lies in one of the Milky Way's many galactic arms, but in the direction of intergalactic space. Earth and our solar system sit in between that spiral arm and most of the rest of the Milky Way. Orion is, for the northern hemisphere of Earth, a winter constellation, and for the southern hemisphere, a summer constellation. In either case, the best time to view Orion is in the month of January. Orion rises from the east soon after sunset, and before bedtime, it's high in the sky. In late fall, Orion sets in the west before dawn, and is easily visible before heading to work or school. Now this is the view of Orion you're most familiar with, the shoulders and legs clearly visible, and perhaps a bow or animal stretched out in front. When you are out camping or traveling away from the city, you might see Orion a bit more like this, with a sheath, a right arm stretched upward, and perhaps what might seem like a sea of stars surrounding him. So let's name some of these more familiar stars and talk about their names. Bellatrix roughly translates from Latin as warrior woman. It's a fitting name for a contemporary pop culture villain. Bellatrix is actually quite a bit closer to Earth than the rest of the stars in Orion. It's a large blue-white star and is extremely hot and quite young at just 25 million years. Rigel's name is of Arabic origin, derived from a phrase that means left leg of Jausa. Jausa is the proper Arabic name given to Orion. Rigel is the seventh brightest star visible from Earth. It is a multiple star system, but the largest star is a super blue giant, and it is about 10 million years old. The Sun, for comparison, is 5 billion years old. It's also a very young star, but it won't last long. Rigel is 74 times the size of the Sun and weighs 18 times as much. Rigel has already exhausted much of its supply of hydrogen and now burns helium. In a few million years, Rigel will end its life in a Type II supernova. But thankfully, it's 800 light years away, too far to affect Earth when that day comes. But Rigel, Orion's foot, isn't nearly as close to death as Orion's shoulder. Betelgeuse comes from the Arabic phrase, and I'll give this one a shot, Upt al Jausa, which means the armpit of Orion. Betelgeuse is a red supergiant, visibly red, in fact, even to the naked eye. It's a loose cannon. It's unstable. It's weird. It's also one of the few stars that can actually be resolved to something bigger than a point or pinprick of light in a telescope. Sort of. Betelgeuse is, well, most of the time, the ninth brightest star in the night sky. That changes over time. The star is variable because it's so unstable. At 600 light years away, it's the closest, most visible red supergiant we have to look at. But because of the constant stability problems, getting good measurements is difficult. Betelgeuse is, for lack of a better phrase, ready to pop at any time in the next few thousand years. In fact, due to the 600-year lag, the amount of time that it takes for light to come to Earth from Betelgeuse, it may have already gone supernova, and the light of that supernova just hasn't reached us yet. Betelgeuse is also still too far away to affect Earth in any negative way. But it's also a runaway star, moving around the Milky Way at a much higher speed relative to its neighbors, perhaps being propelled by an earlier supernova in the area. And in a bit, we might actually see the remnant supernova that caused it to leave its neighborhood. Saif, the right foot of Orion, is named for an Arabic phrase meaning sword of Orion, or just sword for short. Saif is half the size of Rigel, but about as close to us as Betelgeuse. So that rounds out the four corners of Orion. Now, what if we traveled far away from city lights to a national park or a very rural area on a crystal clear night? Now Orion dazzles. The sheath seems a bit fuzzy to our eyes. The constellation becomes difficult to pick out. There are so many stars. The Milky Way's outer spiral arm becomes visible. It looks fantastic. But what if we could go even deeper? What if we collect as much of this unpolluted starlight as we can? Over, let's say, about a minute or so. Now things get crazy. Orion seems to be absolutely drenched in starlight. Weird clouds and colors appear. The right shoulder, Betelgeuse, turns orange, opposed to a dozen bright blue stars. The sheath seems diffuse, blurry, and cloudy. A faint arc of red light seems to frame the body and surround the head of Orion. Now, let's sweep away all the remaining light pollution and sky glow. And let's pretend we have amazing, superhuman color vision. With an hour's worth of photons collected, undisturbed by these effects, and no longer bound by the limits of human eyesight, Orion becomes a colorful, psychedelic laser light show. Now you can see some of the faint signatures of familiar sights you might have seen from NASA, or magazines, or science videos, and more. Check out Orion's belt, Alnitak, Alnilam, and Mintaka. While all three stars have exotic-sounding names, these are names of Arabic origin and refer to rather mundane things. Roughly translated in English, these stars would be named Girdle, Sapphire, and Belt. All three stars are large, bright blue stars, but some of them have companions. In case you haven't already noticed, many star names and even astronomy terms like azimuth have their origins in Arabic and in Middle Eastern astronomy. Much of European or Roman astronomy was lost during the Dark Ages, but astronomy at this time flourished in the Middle East. At the end of the Dark Ages, 700 years ago in Europe, much of this Middle Eastern body of knowledge on astronomy was reintroduced to European cultures, and so the terminology and nomenclature has stuck with us to this day. Near Alnitak, this is where the Horsehead and Flame Nebula are now visible. The red color is due to the ionization of hydrogen gas. We call this light hydrogen alpha, and seeing this light well requires a camera modification, which you can learn more about right here. Technically, this color is visible to the human eye, but too dim to register as a color in most cases without massive optical aids. The Horsehead itself is produced by a dark gas and dust cloud pushing into this hydrogen gas. The Flame Nebula, however, is more of a diffuse mix. Instead of a solid mass of dark cloud, it's spread out, partially revealing a bright emission nebula behind it. But not far at all from the famous Horsehead, in Orion's sheath or sword, are some more spectacular sights. Before, the sheath may have looked like three stars, maybe one fuzzy one, but now are replaced by all of this. Instead, the sword seems like a collection of stars, clouds, and clusters. But let's get some more light to reveal this amazing structure. M42, or the Great Orion Nebula, is clearly one of the most fantastic sights in the night sky, and to think you can actually see it with your own eyes, at least a little bit, from rural setting. At the center of the nebula is the trapezium, a collection of four stars forming a trapezoid. Though it turns out there's actually more like six in there forming that trapezium. Near the Great Orion Nebula is the Bicolored Runningman Nebula. Nebula have regular names or nicknames as opposed to most stars, typically named for their appearance or given the name of the astronomer who discovered it. Many of these nebula were discovered after the mid-1700s by European and American astronomers. Some were even named very recently. One of my favorites is the Pac-Man Nebula. Let's pop down to Rigel again and I'll show you something interesting nearby. Gotta guess what this one is named? This is a reflection nebula called the Witchhead. All of that reflected light is coming from nearby Rigel. So what you are actually seeing here are bits of dust and gas being illuminated by the star. Too bad it isn't near Bellatrix. As we pan back out to the whole of Orion, we can see a massive red arc nearly encircling the constellation. This is called Barnard's Loop, named for its discoverer. The head of Orion is another round nebula region. Many of these nebula tend to be in circular shapes. It's been pretty well established that this circular nature is the result of a supernova, and the later expansion of the gases from that stellar cloud produced by the death of a star. The older the explosion, the bigger and more diffuse that gas cloud becomes. Orion, as a constellation, is full of stars that are ready to go boom, ones that won't last long, and massive supernova remnants that are in turn forming brand new stars all the time. Orion is a busy, beautiful place to see and discover. The amount of literature and science on all of these wonders just in Orion seems almost never ending. Thanks for watching, and if you have any stories or fun pop culture references, please share them in the comments. If you enjoyed this concept, please hit that like button. And if you want to see more of these, please let me know. I'd love to make more. And definitely leave me some suggestions on what constellations to do next. And as always, get outside and learn something new.
We've been to Saturn.
Hey, I've been to Saturn.
Whoa. Sandworms. You hate them, right?
I hate them myself. Come on, kids. What do I have to do?
Get a subscribe out of you two.